Pro Beauty Talks is a podcast series about the professional beauty world. Host Melanie Kopakin, industry strategist and beauty addict, brings you information, education, and inspiration from top beauty industry leaders, gurus, and influencers. This weekly podcast gives you a backstage pass and an up-close look at the people that make things happen. Meet top hairdressers, leaders of product companies, and owners of top salons from around the world. If you are already a part of the Pro Beauty Tribe or just curious about the business of beauty, you won't want to miss a single show. Welcome to Pro Beauty Talks.
Hi, everyone. Melanie Kopakin here, your host of Pro Beauty Talks, a podcast about the professional beauty industry. I am thrilled to have had the opportunity to spend the afternoon with a true beauty industry icon, the legendary Nicholas French. You may not know that Nicholas comes from a very famous British hairdressing family, but I'm sure you do know that he's owned salons, is an educator, artistic designer, and many, many more things, as well as the fact that he has worked in every facet of fashion, beauty, print, and film. Nicholas candidly shared his life's journey and passion for the industry and life as a whole with me. In our interview, he reflects on what he believes is important for all hairdressers to think about and ultimately do to be successful. Thank you for joining me and listening to my interview with Nicholas French. Welcome, Nicholas. Thanks so much for being here.
It's nice to be here. It's going to be a great afternoon.
I'm thrilled that you were able to make this. I know you've been traveling a bit. You know, first of all, I want to say I'm so excited about having you on our show today. You are the true definition of a beauty icon. You come from a very famous British hairdressing family. You've owned salons. You're an educator, artistic designer, and a celebrity hairdresser. You've designed runway hair, worked in print, video, and motion pictures. And as I was thinking about this, I thought, boy, I bet you could write a very exciting autobiography. Have you ever thought about doing that?
Well, we're in the process of putting something together here because with my father's work, which goes back to the 1930s, and my work, which goes back from to the 60s onwards, so we have a huge, great sort of parameter to work with. And I have all my father's Vogue covers here, and I have all the photography that, you know, he did, and I have all the hairstyles and so much information, you know, from those periods. And also, I've been pretty well documented from 1966 onwards to the present day. So we have a huge amount of information. And I think we've got some great stories that we can put down. And, you know, to show hairdressers, it's not just about, you know, working in a salon. There's so much more to what we do than that. And, you know, apart from making a difference in people's lives, you can make a difference in your life as a professional hairdresser by being very creative through all these different channels and opportunities that we have.
Yes, you know, it's interesting because when we set about doing Pro Beauty Talks as a podcast, one of the things that was really important was that we had the opportunity to document our industry like this. And so I think it's so important that that is created and available for this generation and generations to come. So that's really exciting to know that you're working on that.
Yeah, that, I think that, you know, also with all this social media and everything, which helps us terrifically, I think, get the hairdressing word out. But at the same time, I think the skill levels are not quite what they used to be because, you know, in the old days when we took a photograph of the hair, you couldn't sort of say, oh, we'll do everything in post, we can change that, we can change this. You couldn't change anything. So you had to do it for real. And I think that's very interesting. So the skill level, I think, needs to be looked at, you know, revisited as far as hairdressing today are concerned. So they don't just rely on post-production for anything.
Yes, and I think that that's a very significant point because almost all of us now have the opportunity to do this post-production editing and photoshopping, and it's quite easy now as compared to in the past. So it certainly is very, very different. Nicholas, you have created a very interesting and unique learning environment for hairdressers, Skyfall Academy in Palm Springs. And from my understanding, and correct me if I'm wrong, you conduct the programs in New York as well. What inspired you to create Skyfall?
That's a great question. I mean, Skyfall is something that I've dreamt about for many, many years, to create a creative environment for professional hairdressers that is all about hairdressing. It's not about products. It's not about selling anything. It's all about really for the hairdresser, by the hairdresser. So Skyfall is a 1963 iconic home, circular home, on top of a mountain above Palm Springs, which has the most amazing view and most, it's a lovely creative experience being there. But what I thought I would do is do a series of, you know, wonderful two-day hands-on seminars with hairdressers you never really get that close to at shows. Like, for instance, we have this August, we have Martin Parsons for 2 days, and he's going to be doing hands-on. And I actually work with these legends myself. So I'm working as well on the same stage. And then, you know, the attendees have the opportunity to get a hands-on education. And I never have more than 14 people there. So it's very up close and personal. And I have Martin coming, and then I have Vivian McKinder coming the next weekend. Then I have Damien Carney, who is going to do a whole photographic experience at the end of August. So it's a lovely environment. It's a great place to learn. And I think that everybody who's been there has really enjoyed it, because it's all about them, you know, really. It's not about us. It's about the professional hairdresser. And, you know, like my father always said to me when I was very young and very typically English, and he said, you know, when you teach, Nick, it's a matter of putting your hand into the audience and pulling up the audience to level that where you stand as a professional. And that's very, very important, to make them feel part of the whole process and development of their hairdressing mind, i.e. to help them self-start their creative engine. And I think that's important.
Well, it's very exciting, and I hope to visit, actually, in August. I hope I get to come. It would be wonderful.
A lot of visitors we have there from magazines and things, and you know, it's great. You know, they can just sit in, and it's a very beautiful, sort of very laid-back place. At the same time, we cover an awful lot of ground educational-wise, and the whole place is very, very geared to, you know, inside the artist's mind. And I think that instead of a hotel room or a show, it's a very peaceful, wonderful place where people can really open their minds up, feel relaxed, not feel intimidated, and get the chance to be up close and personal with some of these great hairdressers who I've always admired, you know, and I've always wanted to work next to, because, you know, I it's a learning experience, hairdressing, and after 51 years of hairdressing, I still, every day, I learn something new, you know, and I always think, in terms of, when was the last time I created new, something new for the first time? I'm very, you know, I have to write that on a piece of paper some days when I'm doing teachings. It has to be about spontaneity. It has to be about, one has a responsibility to the students or the attendees to really take them to the next level, and also to open their minds up. And like I said before, to self-start their creative engines, which is the most difficult thing to do when you're in a salon, behind a chair, day after day after day. And I've done that, you know. And that's why I reached out to different places, you know, like different experiences, like with print work and cinematography, totally different animals from behind the chair. But it trains your eye to have a clean eye, so you can very clearly see balance, proportion, and shape, and understand who's sitting in your chair.
Well, you've certainly created a very inspirational environment with Skyfall. And you just mentioned being very English. So I was wondering if you could share a little bit about your life path with me, where you grew up, who your mentors were, and why you became a hairdresser. And I know you come from this incredible family of hairdressers. Tell me about that.
Well, I had two elder brothers who weren't interested in hairdressing, actually, at all. They went into other mediums. Like, one was a great painter, a great artist, and my eldest brother, who's still with us, he invented fashion forecasting in menswear, womenswear, fabric, furnishings, lifestyle. He created this whole sort of forecasting echelon where people, you know, and companies could forecast what was going to happen in fashion, you know, as far as fabric colors, silhouettes, etc., etc. So he didn't really want to do hair. So I was the youngest, and my father pressurized me a bit to do hair. So I didn't really enjoy it to start with. Well, I've been sort of assisting my father since I was about 10 years old, you know. And I loved the salons and stuff. But it was a hard path. So I started with my father, and then I went to a young guy who was doing some very different things with hair, and it was Vidal Sassoon. And I went to see him, and all I had was drawings of hairstyles because I could draw. And I showed the drawings to Vidal and other staff around him, like Robert Adele, who was there at the time, and Christopher Brooker. And they said, well, he's got a great eye. Let's take him on, you know. And they were aware that Freddy French of London in those days was very famous. So they were aware of that. So my father didn't really speak to me for 3 years. And I worked for Sassoon for $20 a week or something. And I worked in restaurants at night to make up the money. And I stayed in one room. And I was very determined to do something different from where my father sat in the industry. So that was important to me. And that's how really I started. And then everything else was very, you know, self-motivated as far as seeking different things to do with hair.
And so your father was a mentor at an early age, but did you really know you were going to be a hairdresser? When did that happen for you?
Oh, I think from the age of 14, 15. Then I was sort of committed to it. And you know, I got into it. I found it very difficult to live up to my dad's fame and everything, you know, so I was very nervous to sort of start it. You know, I was quite sick originally because I got quite ill, actually. I almost had a nervous breakdown because of the pressure of my father. And that's when I went to Vidal and I worked with them for a couple of years to get away from that whole thing. And when I went back, I went to America in 1969, actually, very early. I worked in one of the first unisex salons in the world called, ironically, Blood, Sweat and Scissors, which is run by Martin Lewis, who was a Vidal Sassoon hairdresser, English, and in Atlanta. And I worked there for a year. Then I came back. I worked for a company called Molton Brown, which is very sort of almost like a hippie salon. It's beautiful. And I worked there. So I had lots of experience in different areas of the industry before I started up on my own with my own salons. I was sort of thrown into it, really. But at the end of the day, as I gathered speed in the sort of 70s, I remember I did my first Vogue 10 pages in 1976. And in 1972, I did the first Cosmopolitan cover ever in England, in the world, actually, which was great. So I started to do photographic work, and that really honed my eye in, you know, to doing a different kind of work, really. And individuality was important to me, to do something somebody hadn't done before. So I always tried new things out. Sometimes you have to go through bad things to get to good things, you know? And I did that many, many times. But I have a vast archive of all my work that's been printed, you know, and all the work that's been videoed, et cetera, et cetera. So that's how I sort of began. You know, it was a learning curve, really, for me.
Nicholas, your work is absolutely beautiful and awe-inspiring and always has been as far as I'm concerned. Where does your inspiration come from?
The inspiration is quite interesting. I had a class 2 days ago in Madison, Wisconsin, the one before in Milwaukee. And I live in Long Island in West Hampton. And, you know, not far from here is, as an example, this is an example of inspiration. Not far from here is Jackson Pollock's studio. And Jackson Pollock was an artist in the 1950s who worked at the same time as Picasso, de Kooning, and they were trying to do different things. And Jackson Pollock's wife was a brilliant artist, and she said to him, you know, he's becoming boring because he was a little bit over the top, and he drank a lot and did all kinds of stuff, and he was a mess. And he tripped up into the studio, which was a barn in East Hampton, and his paint spilt on this canvas, and then he was onto something new. And his last painting sold for $18.2 million, which was like drizzles and drips of colour, and with this lovely sort of stringy texture to it. And so I went to see this, the floor in his beautiful barn, and it was all stained with his work. And I went back home, and I literally gathered some horse's hair, threw it on a table, glued it all together very, very finely, and then I threw paint on it, splashed it around, and then I dried it all out, and I cut it into shapes and put it onto a head. And suddenly I had something new, some new textures, introducing colour, and we photographed it. It looked absolutely stunning. So often you have to look away from hairdressing to be inspired, you know? It might be art. It might be, you know, a wheat field in Tuscany I remember seeing, and I created something that looked like wheat blowing in the wind. But in fact, the hair didn't blow. It was all put together. But there's so many different places you can find inspiration from. But really look away from, you know, hairdressing. Look away from hair. Look into something else and see, you know, get a temperature reading of something new and fresh. And like I said, sometimes you do things and you throw it into the bin, you know. But I think then you've got to really work through it, because the first attempts are very raw. And then you finesse and you finesse and you finesse and refine and refine and refine. And then you find a way of using, you know, your inspiration and converting it into hair fashion. And I really believe that avant-garde work is not fantasy. I would think of it more as fine art. So that's my sort of rationale when I approach all these different sort of ideas, you know. I hope that makes sense.
Yes, it totally makes sense. And it's really just opening your entire mind to what's available in the universe and removing blinders and just letting it come in. Have you ever been frustrated or stuck creatively?
Oh, yeah. It's like you get things like it's like writer's block, you know. I won't do things for the sake of doing it. This year was one of the first times I didn't enter Naha, actually. Because I was judging a lot of the contestants as well. I'm a judge for Naha. I have been for several years. But I thought, you know what, there's nothing that I really feel that I want to do as far as Naha's concerned that's really new and fresh. And I am working on something where the hair actually looks like bone. It's very interesting. But it's not there yet. So the great late Alexander McQueen always loved those kind of textures. And I should have been working with something to that effect. So, unless it's right, I think I might shoot this with a great photographer I know for next Naha, you know, but I won't do something for the sake of doing it. And I see some of the Naha things going on. Some of it's fabulous. Some of it's amazing. Some of it's very Me Too that I've seen years ago, which I don't quite understand, because I think as hairdressers, we have to be responsible in a creative way, rather like fashion designers, to create something that hasn't been seen before, you know? And I think that's the premise of what I do. It cannot be seen before. It has to be new. It has to mean something. And it has to put hairdressers in the limelight, you know? And I think that's important. Once I was in a foreign country and they said to me at an interview, interesting story, why somebody of your age, because obviously I'm not 25, come to teach our young people how to do hair? And I didn't know. I said, well, thank you for the question. And I looked out the window and I saw a Calvin Klein ad. And I said, can I ask you a question? I asked them, you know what, how old is Calvin Klein? I mean, he was 65 at the time. How old is Giorgio Armani? He's 82. How old is Valentino? How old is Ralph Lauren? Do you think they've had any influence on young people? I think so. Also, the difference between a couture designer, who I love, is the fact they can choose their fabric, they can colour it, they can cut it, they can create it, and we can place it on a beautiful woman, where our fabric is a live human being sitting in a chair in front of us, and we have to change the texture of their hair, we have to change who they are, basically. And I think that's very, very important to understand what we do as professional hairdressers, you know? And my father always used to say, if you understand the inside of the head, and you have a chance of getting the outside of the head. Right. And then as he walked out the door, he said, well, good luck, Nick. But I think the understanding of who we are as hairdressers sometimes gets missed. And I think we have to really refocus and, you know, recharge our minds and say, well, actually, this is what we really do. You know, we make a difference in people's lives and we change their lives. It can be quite dramatically, actually. And because we're working with live human people, live human beings. So, you know, if you do avant-garde work, it's a matter of seeking other textures, seeking other colours, and then it trickles down to the real world. And I think that's the most important thing, that it has the reason, not just for the sake of it, it has a reason for developing something new.
Have you ever gotten to a point where you thought, gosh, you were depleted creatively and you just didn't want to be a hairdresser anymore?
Oh, yeah, many a time, actually. Yeah, many a time. When you do different kinds of work for a living, I was a session hairdresser, you know, that was one of my primary activities, and I had a salon owner. And I used to do like 20 shoots a month, you know. Some of it might have been TV commercials, some of it might have been a bit of a motion picture. And some of those things are so boring. You just stand there doing the same hair every day for continuity and stuff. And you think, well, why am I doing this? You know, because you need to make revenue to open salons up and support staff and things. And, you know, and then you get a bit lost. You know, why am I doing this when I could be doing something very exciting? Because most of the work is can be quite boring. You know, it's what you make of it. And I think, you know, if you photograph your clients for 2 weeks, their hairstyles, and put it on a wall at home on a weekend or something and look at it, you'd be very surprised at what you see. And I've done that several times when I had my salons, and I remember seeing, oh my goodness, it's the same haircuts, the same styles. I'm not really moving forwards. I'm stuck in a rut because I was so tired. I'm doing, you know, 12 to 15 clients a day in those days, and I wasn't moving forwards. And I thought, why am I doing this? It's just, you know, being really repetitive, you know. And that's why I always say you've got to self-start your creative mind and really think about what you're doing. And I remember teaching the other day, I was doing a haircut, actually, and they had a hands-on, they had these lovely models, and this girl had the most awful haircut. And the girl who was attending to her, the hairdresser, said, I don't know what to do. And I said, well, comb it around, you know, let's have a look. See what we've got, that we can really open a face up. And then between us, she said, oh, my goodness, that looks better. I said, yeah. You just got to comb the hair around, look at the face, look at the person, talk to the client, and then you can find a way of, even with this haircut that wasn't it the student's fault, somebody before cut it, it's pretty horrendous. We found a way of creating a fresh new shape for her to sort of grow out into something else. And it's having that clean eye, I think, and being innovative, you know? And I think don't imitate, innovate, and just breathe and take your time. And always in the salon, I was behind, you know. My wife was a receptionist in the early days. And I said to the next client who'd been waiting for 25 minutes, I said, look, I'll spend as much time as possible with your hair to make you look fantastic. I'm not going to be, you know, ruled by time. You know, it's all about doing something very special for you. And I found at the end of the day that I had masses of clients, and they loved that, and they came with their books and their work and whatever, and they let me loose on them. So they knew at the end of the day they're going to look great, and they're going to look individual. It wasn't just me too. You know, they had to look very themselves, and it's all about personalities, you know? I think that's what it's about as well, which people tend to miss and not really understand who's sitting in their chair, you know? And that can be missed. You know what I mean? That can be missed. I mean, I do a thing called the fashion wheel, which is like a circle. On the top is a classical client, on the bottom is an edgy client. And then in between, you have all these parameters, these different tribes of people that you have to sort of recognize who you're dealing with, you know? And then you have to recognize the hair type, which is basically fabric. You know, you're going to dye it and cut it and whatever. A bit like a designer, but at the same time, it's a living fabric, you know? And I think a lot of that, you know, if we slow down, look back into what we're doing, we're going to understand what we do much more clearly, you know, and what the reason us being here is. I think that can be missed by doing day after day, month after month, working in a salon, you know, because you need to pay your bills and everything else and whatever. And then the whole reason gets lost. And I think that often I see that in my travels, you know, that people have got stuck in a rut and they need to do something totally different. Go away and it's a different country for a week or and do something totally different, you know, go on a pottery course or do painting or just something totally different so you can get back into that creative mode, you know, and feel fresh again. Fresh is a big word, you know.
Yes, yes. I listened to an interview you did when you discussed the importance of recognizing that designing hair is different than designing clothing, for example, because the hair is attached to a human. And I know I'm kind of paraphrasing here, but tell me how that helps or impedes the design process.
Well, I think that, you know, you've got to understand face shapes, you know? You've got to really understand face shapes and bone structure. Like, Vidal Sassoon always had an architectural approach to it, you know? In fact, the man who started the geometry of hair was Raymond, who was a great hairdresser in the 1950s in London, and Vidal actually worked with him for a little bit. And Raymond had these tiny little shears, and started to sort of build geometric silhouettes. And so that's really where it all came from. And then Vidal was trained to be an architect, and he loved the Bauhaus, the movement. And then he took it further. I mean, I have pictures of Vidal Sassoon back brushing hair, you know, with full sort of bouffant hairstyles, you know. I mean, the geometric sort of haircut didn't really come in until the sort of 66, 67, you know. And that was quite interesting because people hated it because it was flat hair. And they're used to seeing it with full hair, you know, which was insane. So it was a very different sort of approach because if you think in the history of hairdressing that, you know, you can go to the 30s, the 40s, the 50s, and the early part of the 60s, it was all uniformity. Everybody looked the same. You know, the 50s, for instance, everybody had hoop skirts, they had white gloves, and they had very similar silhouetted hair. And the 60s sort of began to break away towards the end of the 60s, but not really that much, you know. And then that was really uniform. You know, you saw this heavily teased hair and the sort of bob shapes and things, you know. And you weren't allowed to backcomb hair after a while at Vidal Sassoon's, which is really interesting, you know. I mean, I cut as a singer. She's been long gone now. She's wonderful, called Dusty Springfield. And she loved to have her hair backcombed. It was like a bob, graduated bob, all backcombed up, you know. And I cut her hair several times, and I had to do it in the garden behind, in Sloane Street, behind Vidal Sassoon. And he came through one day, said, "What are you doing, Nicholas, out in the garden, you know, doing hair?" I said, "But we won't let anybody backcomb hair or tease hair in the salon." And so Dusty loves it. So before she leaves, I backcomb it and throw her out the back door. You know, it was crazy. It was crazy days. But the thing is that it started changing hair from uniformity because, ironically, in London in the 1940s, so 46, 47, there were three groups of hairdressers that you learned from, three different schools of hairdressing in the world. One was English, one was Italian, and the other was French. Can you believe that? And they really ruled the techniques that we used worldwide. So that's the three groups of hairdressers that really had techniques that you learned from. And for instance, in Vidal Sassoon's book, he mentions about meeting my dad when he was 17. And he went to this polytechnic school, which was like a little university, actually. And they had different people, like painters there and whatever. And then one night they have hairdressers on Thursday nights. And they were demonstrating hairstyles. And the attendees could ask them questions. And Vidal said in his book, "I was to drive this guy mad." But if he came on, he was a very short man, very beautiful clothes he wore. And he did hair that was so different, so out there. And he said, quote unquote, "At last, a glimpse of the future," because what my dad did was to actually let the hair move like fabric. So when the client got up from the chair, her hair moved, and nobody had ever seen that before because it was all, you know, set, you know, with pin curls and like glued in with lacquer. So he was the first person to really free hair up, and he was the first person ever to cut hair palm to palm. He actually discovered that before the war because he worked in an orphanage cutting orphans' hair, and he gave them a penny back so he could experiment in cutting hair. So he, lots of things he was a breakthrough sort of hairdresser with. And that's why I always have the same, I always think back of what Dad did, and, you know, how he helped invent the Denman brush and use it in a different way and stuff like that. So, you know, I've been lucky to have that kind of heritage that I can still look back on, you know. We were working the other day in this beautiful school, we were actually working, and I showed them techniques from the 1950s that you can use today in haircutting, and they were just totally blown away because it was creating seamless layers, but the way it was done was pretty outrageous. But it wasn't a gimmick, it was a technique. Technique stays the same, but fashion is fleeting. So it's a matter of all of us getting as much technique in our bones as we can, and then when we see ahead, and we have a, you know, it's all about resolving things. It's about resolving problems with hair. It's about really doing what we want to do with hair. But at the same time, we have to resolve the problems that exist within the hair types. So I think it's quite an interesting dichotomy how everything is sort of groups around technique, groups around, you know, I mean, nothing has really changed in the industry, I don't think, except for hair products. Everything is totally different with hair products. And that's made the difference, you know? In the last 50 years or so, it's been incredible.
Nicholas, what advice would you give a young hairdresser who's just starting out today?
The advice I would give to anybody, And I met a lot of young, great people, like at the Beacon thing around Naha. You know, it's lovely to meet all these young, very enthusiastic people. And I think really a couple of things that Churchill said in the Second World War, actually. Nobody really knew who he was, actually, the young people. But it's like, never, never, never give up. If you're sort of going through hell, keep going. Because, you know, hairdressing is one of those things that if you're not feeling comfortable, you're not learning something new. And I think that people tend to stay within their safety area, you know, a safe zone where they know they can do this and they don't want to learn anything that makes them feel uncomfortable. And I always do when I teach, I say, if you feel uncomfortable, embrace it. You're learning something new, you know? I remember several years ago, I went to Sassoon's and just a course and whatever, we took a few people there. And they said, what are you doing in it? I said, well, show me something so different. There's a wonderful girl there in Santa Monica, I'm trying to remember who it was, and she took me through this haircut, these zigzag partings. It was quite complicated. And I did a haircut, it took me 5 hours, and a real person. And we colored their hair like swan white. And it was amazing. You know, I felt so excited because it took me 5 hours to do this haircut correctly. And I just thought it was brilliant that these guys could teach me something I'd never even seen before. And it was all about shorter pieces of hair, pushing longer pieces up in different areas of the head. It's brilliant. And I felt, wow, you know, I felt that's so different, that's so new. And then I suddenly realized what it took to learn that. I had to feel really uncomfortable, you know? And I was doing it on a live person who had never even met me before. And I did it for all those hours. And they actually loved it in the end. And I kept doing it, you know, different things, with variations on a theme. But it was something that's totally new for me. And I thought that was great. And I think you need to, you know, just be very, very ambitious and also listen an awful lot. Just soak it up. Listen to everybody. And take the journey. Don't look at the destination. When I first went to a hair show, Interquaffure, my dad was the president for 6 years in Great Britain of Interquaffure. And I went when I was about 16 and a half years old. And I went into the show, and a guy called Silvio Camillo, who was a lovely Italian hairdresser, was working. And my dad said to me afterwards, did you like what he did? And I said, no, I hated it. I said, it's very old-fashioned, dated. It was nice and shiny, but it wasn't, mate. It's not what's going on now, Dad. Not. He said, well, did you see the way he stood? Did you see where he held the razor, how he razor cut the hair? Did you see the way he pin-curled it? Did you see the way he dried it? Did you see the way he used the brush? Did you see how great this woman looked when the hair just came across her cheekbones very lightly? And all the weight distribution, the balance proportion and shape? I said, I didn't see any of that, Dad. No, you know what your problem is, Nicholas? You never took the journey. You just looked at the destination. And you are a brand. So you would do the styling of it totally different anyway. But the technique was amazing. You know? It was fantastic. And like Sylvia had hardly any products to use at all. I mean, you know, I think he just about had a hairspray, which was like a lacquer. And he had pure alcohol setting lotions in those days in a glass vial, and that was about it. Mousse wasn't really around then, you know? So it's like he had nothing to work with, but you made this woman look amazing, but the style was old-fashioned. So I thought, ooh, you know, not my cup of tea. I want to do something really modern. But I didn't learn anything because I didn't look at the process of what he did and how he worked through all these techniques to get to where he wanted to get to, you know? Because, you know, the other thing that I learned that my dad told me, he said, if you fail to prepare, prepare to fail. So it's all in the preparation of the hair. And also to over-prepare it sometimes. You can always take it out, but you can't put it in if it's not there, you know?
Right, that makes perfect sense. Fabulous advice also for young hairdressers to really, you know, breathe through this and take their time to look at the journey of the creation and to absorb those techniques. Nicholas, one of the things I think is really important to discuss is you have really made a difference in the world of beauty in all of these different areas, and you are an icon for a reason. Now, you've made a difference, and so I think it's kind of hard, kind of maybe a hard question to answer, but what advice would you give other stylists that want to make a difference in the world? It's wonderful to be working behind the chair and to do great work, yet bigger than life. How do you reach out and just share your knowledge and make a difference?
Well, I don't, you know, I'm like a chef who doesn't like his own food, you know, really. So I'm always seeking a different, it's true. When I used to work in the film business, and a lot of the TV commercials I work in, like special effects, you know, and for instance, it's a good story because I was just really a hair cutter, you know, originally. And then I met an amazing woman called Ingrid Clee, who was much older than me, actually, became a girlfriend. And she did beautiful dress work. And then she taught me one or two long hairstyles. And I could never do it until about 1970. And then I sort of started doing different things and I had different interests. And I thought, you know, I'm just going to try and be original and fresh. And, you know, I can't reach for the moon and catch the star on the way down. I have to really, you know, experience everything in between. And I think, you know, I think to people, oh, I'm a colorist. I said, well, no, you're an artist, you know? You're not just a colorist. You're not just a hairdresser. It's like the great Vivian McKinder said, oh, you're not just a hairdresser. And she's right. You know, you've got to really think in terms of you have a responsibility for an art form, I think. And hairdressers never got a good rap with that. So my sort of thing was to really show the world that hairdressers are artists, you know? And from a very early age, really, and I had the opportunity, you see, that was a big difference. I worked in a store that was like a Barney's in London called a Harvey Nichols, very trendy store. I went to the PR and I said, why aren't I doing the hair? I'm the artistic director of this hair salon. We don't want people from, it's like a Glenby company, a bit like Regis. Oh, from that, I said, what's he talking about? I can do hair for magazines, you know? And I showed them some pictures I did. And then they said, what about next Thursday? You've got 10 pages in Vogue. You do the hair, Nick. And I really frightened the hell out of me, you know? And I did it. And it was on an African-American girl, actually, called Janet Stevenson. I'd never done that kind of hair before. And I just did it in a different way. And the rest is history. I just started doing all kinds of different things with hair, you know? My interest grew through photography. So what you're doing, you're looking through a camera, and like I said, in those days, you couldn't retouch anything. So you had to make the hair look perfect. And I think that's it all is about P's, begins with a P. Perfection, precision, perseverance, you know, a lot of pain. And it's all about P's. And it really is, you know, so I thought, while I'm here, why don't I try and do something really different? You know, it's like when I went into hair shows in the late 70s, 1970s, not the 1870s, I did hair shows, and I actually did all my photographic work I put in magazines. In those days, there were 67 hairdressing magazines around the world, and that's how I started my career doing hair shows, because people said, wow, this guy's great, you know, let's get him over to Australia, let's get him over to wherever it was. And I started, you know, in those days, you didn't just work for one product company. You worked for one weekend, you were with Weller, next weekend with L'Oreal, next weekend with Choice somewhere. It didn't really matter. It was in different parts of the world. I wasn't really a product person. I was a hairdresser's hairdresser always from the beginning. So in the 1970s, you know, we pioneered doing hair shows, but you had to do something amazingly beautiful and amazingly well, okay? So after years and years and years of doing that, you have to seek different shapes, different ideas, you know, and I think that's what really, if you have a responsibility, then that's what you really helps you develop your career. And then people come up to you and ask you things, you know. I mean, I did a TV commercial once, which was like a film, and they said, we want the hair in the shape of a cat, a cactus, and a bird. I said, I can do that, no problem at all. So I run out of this advertising agency thinking, how on earth am I going to do that? And I found a sculptor who sculpted with balsa wood, like model era painter, sculptor, and he sculpted the shapes in balsa wood. I hand-laid the hair and put it in a wig oven, because I worked with a few wigs in the film business, and baked them, and then I put it on the girl's head. And the director said, my goodness, that looks like a cat. That looks like a cat. That looks like a bird. And I said, that's what you wanted. She said, it's too real, you know? And I said, oh, my goodness. But then I got well-known for doing special effects for that one TV commercial. Then it ended up, oh, can you do a punk dog? Can you do this? Can you do that? And the whole thing developed in me being like a special effects sort of hairdresser, which is started me off in the avant-garde, you know. So I had to do different things with hair. with different foundations, you know, and I had to create shapes people had never seen before. And I was forced into doing it by all these quirky TV commercials and special effects for films and everything else, you know. It's like crazy, but that's how it all started. And then I had the salons, I worked doing regular people, but at the same time, I was up the mountains in Wales doing some extraordinary, you know, hairstyle or whatever. And that's how it really started. So that's how my interest started. But I never said no. I said, I can do this. And I found a solution, a way of creating hair that looked like a masterpiece of fine art and, you know, placing it on people's hair for certain, you know, jobs. And that's how I really started. And it seems to have sort of gone on that way, you know, which has been very interesting, you know. So I never got bored. I never got bored. Everything was a bit of a nightmare sometimes, you know. And I started by taking a job over that somebody messed up, which was the cactus, the tap and the bird. And the story of the commercial was really interesting because it was done like the lighting was done like the abyss. So it was all blue lighting. You saw these sort of shapes. And they all went through this amazing waterfall. And it was a shampoo ad, actually. And then they came out the other side looking like Giorgio Armani models, you know. But it was all, you know, frequent wash hair, you know, dry hair with the cactus and flyaway hair with the bird. And so it was like crazy. But that sort of opened the doors to, you know, runway shows, to film, to this, to that. Just by that one, people say, who the heck did that hair? It's amazing. And it looks like it's growing out of their heads. That was the key. It looked like it was going out of the girls' heads, you know?
Yes, I think that's tremendous advice because you said something really important. You said you never said no. And you didn't wait for someone to come along. So often I hear young hairdressers say, well, I don't do that because I need someone to teach me.
Yeah. That's not really the case. I mean, I've done mobile, I've done kinetic hair, which actually moves. Engine-driven hair, if you will, you know? I've actually done that. And that was a bit of a disaster because it stopped right in the middle of the shop. But, you know, I've actually done things that are that insane. But I found a way of doing it. And people were saying in the audience, it was at Asia, my God, that girl's hair's moving, you know. Why is it moving? Because it was motorized. It was actually motorized with one of those toy, which was insane. And we did it. I remember when we did that. The engine kept breaking down, which was a bit unfortunate. And then I remember I had a volunteer who was an older guy. And I said, love to have you on board here. It's going to be a fantastic show. What are your hobbies? He says, I fly my own planes. I said, you're a pilot. He said, no, you don't get it. I've got these model airplanes I fly around. I said, absolutely perfect. Bring all your kids. And he found a way of making this little engine work, you know. So it was good. It's amazing, you know. You've just got to be fearless, I think. And you know, you have terrible days when you get, like, writer's block. And, you know, I'm thinking about a shoot at the moment that I'm going to do. You know, I just need to be able to breathe. I travel around quite a lot. And if only I could get up the top of a mountain or something and just sit there, but I can't. So, you know, I have to really train myself to detach myself from the world and really draw out. I love to draw. I always draw everywhere, really. You know, pictures of what I can imagine, you know, shapes and things that I haven't seen before, you know. And I think hairdressers, if you want to do avant-garde work, look at some of these great hat designers like Philip Treacy and, you know, these marvellous sort of hat designers. And some of the shapes, if you get their books out and everything, and Stephen Jones, and the textures of what they've done, you know. And also film is amazing. I mean, you know, if you look at the Elizabeth I, the Golden Age, some of the most incredible hairdressing you've ever seen in your life. You know, there's some amazing hairdressers in film. You know, Stephen Jones, I know, used laser to make these very fine headpieces on top of their hair, you know? So there's lots of things you should really look at, you know, that's to do with hair as well. I mean, you know, I thought that was really great hair, and I thought the young Victoria was brilliant hairdressing. Victorian shapes are generally very ugly, and these hairdressers in the films made you look absolutely stunning, you know? So that's where you have to look. I mean, I've been lucky. I've been in studios like years ago where they made The Last Emperor, you know, they did all the wardrobe and stuff. And I see these people working, you know. The one woman to look at is Jenny Shakur. She's actually did Elizabeth the Golden Age hair for it. Quite amazing woman. And I think that's where we can learn from other people, you know, and don't be afraid to ask questions and learn from people that are in different areas of the business. And I think that's a good thing to do as well. You know, I think because it really hones your skills. You know, you've only got one set of hands, and I think you have to put your hands somewhere else. You know, going to like Roger Thompson, the second artistic director of Vidal Sassoon, who unfortunately passed away at 57. He did all the 5-point haircuts and those marvelous early haircuts he was responsible for. And not many people know, but he was a brilliant sculptor. He was a marvelous sculptor. And he was also ambidextrous, which was terrifying because he can cut with both hands. But he was, you know, people like that, and very, very modest. He could, you know, he was never spoke very much, but just created this amazing hair, you know, and the accuracy of what he did with hair was extraordinary. It was like, just like cutting a fabric, you know? So I think that you've got to get excited about what you do. You have to reinvent yourself. I mean, that word comes to mind. A lot of people said, oh, you know, how you keep reinventing yourself. I said, I need to do it again, you know? I'm getting a bit me too, you know? I'm just staying at the same level because, you know, I like thinking about doing this book. You know, I want it to be something special, not just a, you know, little book about hairdressing. It's got to be more than that.
That's an incredible gift. I'm looking so forward to that. Nicholas, you know, let's shift gears just for a quick second. How do you take care of you? You have a lot of energy and you're going and you're educating and you're in front of, you know, audiences all the time. How do you take care of yourself?
You know, I live out here in West Hampton, which is very beautiful this time of the year, especially. You know, I try and do other stuff, but, you know, it's difficult. You know, over the years, I've done all kinds of different things, you know, sports-wise and whatever, to get my mind off it. Great tennis fiend. I played a lot of tennis. I just had my hip replaced last December, so that was tough. But, you know, like 7:15 tomorrow morning, a friend of mine is brilliant. He's coming down to my tennis court, and we're going to hit tennis balls, you know, for an hour and a half, you know, just get me out of my sort of, you know, all the stress level and everything else. But, you know, I draw a lot, I paint a lot. You know, I try and do interesting things with my life. But, you know, I think it's just so to keep an open mind and to see other people's work is amazing, you know. And I talk to a lot of different people and I've worked with some amazing people in my life, you know. And I think that, you know, a lot of the time you spend your whole life running around, chasing whatever you're chasing, and you never really get to experience the world we live in and to travel. I love to travel to see other places, other cultures, you know, and I've really one example of how you can, you know, create an outside interest in the world is like I was in Kenya in the 1980s and putting together a show, which is another long story, but to cut it short. And I said to the guide I had, who was a wonderful African guy called with a wonderful name called Livingstone, right? Dr. Livingstone. And I said, Livingstone, where did these Maasai guys get their hair done? It's amazing. The Maasai Kenyan tribe, who average height of the men is 7'2", and they have this incredible long red hair, like beads and it, and just very, very, very long red hair. And he said, let me see if I can get you to where they create this hair. But it might be difficult because it's a very private thing for this particular tribe. Anyway, we drove 5 hours into the Maasai Mara, which is like into Kenya, into the middle of nowhere with amazing animals just walking around like giraffes and stuff. Like it's like a film. It's insane, you know. And after 5 hours, we got to this river. And lo and behold, there was like a dozen guys sitting on these rocks and the two women to each guy. And they were actually adding string to their hair. And then this river had this extraordinary mud, which was like a sort of henna effect. And it dyed their hair and the string red. And then it baked in the sun, and then, lo and behold, they had this amazing hair. And they were very nervous when I was there, but, you know, in their own language, my guy spoke to them, and they weren't, I couldn't take any photographs, nothing, which I wouldn't do. But I just experienced that, and I thought, my goodness, isn't it great to be a hairdresser? You know, isn't it wonderful that I can experience these things? Nobody will ever experience that, ever, you know? And so I've been privileged in that way. So I'm always looking at different things, and I always think of that. And I have a wonderful painting here of a Maasai wedding, actually, from somebody who was actually in Kenya. And it's got, you can see the hair and everything. It's amazing. So I mean, that's just one little example of, I'm always looking at the historical side of hair because, you know, hair really denoted who you were in society. you know, in the early days, you know, and I think that was quite interesting in itself. So, you know, just keep yourself entertained, I think. Keep your mind open and also just learn to let it go. If it's not working out, just let it go and find a solution. Just, you know, even with clients, you just, what is his hair? You know, just try and just relax a little bit more and just see what you're doing. Just make everything, you're only as good as the last thing you did, really. So, you know, do it beautifully, do it with a great heart and an open mind. Easier said than done. But, you know, just get away from hairdressing for a couple of weeks if you have to. Go and do something different, you know. And I think that's, you know, go to drawing classes, flower arranging classes I've been to. I've been to all kinds of different things because I think that keeps the mind sort of fresh, you know. Like I said, I've been hairdressing, I think it's 288,450 days or something crazy, which is like 51 years. But I was always interested in you know, in so many things in life, in the art world, and I think that's what one's got to do, you know. And the most important thing is, and it's the same with painters, it's like Jackson Pollock, it's like Picasso, it's like anybody really, it's having the idea. That's the most difficult thing to understand, to have the idea. And it has to be new, it has to be fresh, it has to be something that's fun, might be whimsical, might be very serious, but just getting a new idea, something new and fresh that nobody's ever seen before. You know, like I said, technique is, you know, stays the same, but, you know, the idea in the moment and fashion is fleeting. So, you know, we have to really address that. I hope that makes sense to you in
yes.
my English accent, which is
absolutely. Don't ever yeah. change a thing. Nicholas, thank you so much for that. Now, let's back up, if we could, before we close today. Can you tell me how people would find out, our listening audience would find out more about Skyfall?
Yeah, if it was Skyfall, it's really an amazing place. And we actually do courses at Skyfall. And we're actually doing some I'm doing one with Vivian McKinder, I think, in November in the middle of New York as well. So there's lots of opportunities. And if you look at nicholasfrench.com and look under education, you'll see what I do and what we offer as well, you know, and that also leads to contacting me, and I do actually get back to everybody. So if you'll contact me and any questions you have, and I'm very transparent, so you can phone me or email me or just look at all the my website, and it explains everything. So we only do a very special event, you know. We love people to be involved and to do things that are unique, you know, and I think that's the most important thing.
Okay, so that's www.nicholasfrench.com, correct?
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Awesome. And your website is beautiful, too, by the way.
Oh, thank you. And it leads you to everything else you need to know. You know, if you want contact me, just get hold of me. You know, you can even phone me up and put my phone numbers and everything on it. Just email me and, we get back to you, because these courses are very sort of limited. We don't have any more than about 14 people in each sort of class for the 2 days. And the great thing is that in Palmer Springs, it's quite reasonable to stay there, and it's a fun place, and it's only 4 minutes away by an Uber or, you know, Lyft to a house, which is very unusual. And if you look at Skyfall, look up Skyfall Palmer Springs, it should come up, the actual house itself, so you'll see the whole interior and everything and how it worked. But you'll see it on my website as well, and, you know, how people are interacting there and everything else. And I think that, you know, education's a really good investment, you know, and that's what it's really about. You've got to invest in the future and invest in yourself, you know. And it's funny, when I first did this about 4 years ago, the first group that came, and I was just on my own doing it, I said, my goodness, I've worked with you guys for years at Matrix, you know. And they said, yeah, Nick, but we've helped you out for years, but we've never had the opportunity to sit here for 2 days and soak up all the techniques, and we're dying to learn them. But we're only with you for like a couple of hours at a time, you know. And it was fantastic, and they loved it. And they're all coming back, you know, repeat business and stuff. And it's, you know, it's just, it's all about creativity and all, you know, and feeding the soul and feeding the mind, really, isn't it? Because you all get sort of exhausted and, you know, washed up. And I think that's what it's about, you know, and your creativity needs to be fed. And also you get that enthusiasm back to, when you get back to the salon, that client comes in and says, wow, you know, I just had a great experience. But I said, let's look at your hair again. What are we doing? Where are we going with it? How do you feel about it? You know, and get people really motivated, clients motivated about themselves, because they tend to stay the same for too long, you know. So you've got to change them up, and you need new techniques, new ideas, and then it's easy, you know, and it's fun. And I think that's the thing.
Thank you so very much for spending time with me today. I appreciate it so much. I think this was lovely. This was wonderful.
Yeah, I had a good time as well. It's a bit of a, I try and stop talking every now and then, but it's difficult.
But it's all about talking. It's all about sharing. And I can't thank you enough for being a part of our Pro Beauty Talks podcast series.
Always my pleasure. Anytime.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for listening to this episode of Pro Beauty Talks. We are dedicated to bringing you the latest information about the professional beauty industry. You can subscribe to our podcast by visiting us on iTunes, Google Play, and Stitcher. Check out our website at www.probeautytalks.com. You can also find us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. If you have a question or suggestion for a future guest or topic, or if you're interested in sponsoring an episode of Pro Beauty Talks, please message us on our Facebook page or email our host at melanie@probeautytalks.com. Until then, we wish you a beautiful day.